This tip, the right way to use IRAC on a law school exam. IRAC, it's the basic framework that you're given both as a law student during 3 years of law school and while taking a bar prep course like Barbary over the summer. It's the basic framework that you're given for answering classic issue spotting exam. Example here, Bilbo Baggins has got Sting, an elven blade, holding the Ring of Power, and he viciously throws, and stabs Gollum in the face with a knife. Shelob, this scary spider, is standing behind. Is Bilbo liable for intent to kill, murder of Gollum? IRAC is supposedly helpful in giving you a way to answer that question. You state the issue, you state the rule for intent to kill, murder, the analysis, you apply the law to the facts, and you've got a conclusion, yes or no, Bilbo didn't intend to kill Gollum. Both law school and bar prep don't really tell you much more about IRAC, other than saying that's the framework. My opinion is that IRAC is more descriptive than it is helpful. That is, any answer to an issue spotting exam will necessarily have these elements to it, the way that any essay will have an introduction, a middle, and a conclusion. We were given this advice in high school, the classic five-paragraph essay, one paragraph being the intro, one paragraph being the conclusion, and three paragraphs in the middle being the body. But any essay, even written badly, will have those elements. I would say any answer would tend to have these elements as well. So this isn't super helpful. I'd like to give you a bit of a framework for IRAC that I think will be more helpful. So I've got this matrix here, I and R kind of closer together, analysis on its own and conclusion here. Down the sides, I've got the function of these parts of IRAC, perhaps how to word it very specifically, and most importantly, the narrative perspective. I think this is what's missing in most instruction on IRAC and the thing that I've noticed in tutoring students. What IRAC really involves, and I think it is one of the key skills that you need to employ as a lawyer, is constant changes in narrative perspective. So let's go back up. Let's start with function. What is the function of the issue and the rule? In my mind, the function of issue and rule, and I would join them together, is that it puts out a legal hypothesis. And here, the question is whether or not Bilbo's throwing the knife constitutes intent to kill, murder. The way that's specifically worded is, did, and this is the generic version, X event, and here, in case you forgot, it's Bilbo throwing a knife in Gollum's face and killing him, did X event constitute Y claim or defense having elements 1, 2, and 3. Now, I'll come back to what I mean by narrative perspective after filling out the rest of this. A correct function of the analysis portion, this is, just calling it analysis is way too vague. Following the scientific model here, the analysis section is data gathering. You're given a number of facts. You can kind of see what's going on here. Bilbo's wearing the Ring of Power, throws Sting in Gollum's face, and there's this giant scary spider behind. The very specific expression of that data gathering is the application of facts to specific elements of law given here. Now, the meta question when reaching the analysis section to me is, when you look at these facts, and this question that I'm about to ask takes place at the element level, 1, 2, 3. Is the application of a given fact to an element an easy issue or a hard one? Let's rewind for a second. If we're looking at murder of Gollum, given the fact that Bilbo has just thrown a knife in Gollum's face and killed him, the actus reus part of the crime is pretty clear. That's done for. And that would be an easy fact. Killed Gollum. A harder issue is, what is going on in Bilbo's mind? Did he mean to kill Gollum because he thought he was coming to get the ring? Or did he mean to throw a knife at the scary spider Shelob? Blood. Hard to know. If we are dealing with a hard question here, analysis is not simply fitting a fact to a given element of the law. For hard issues, we actually go to a mini trial. Looks like a court, it could be a bank. And what is a mini trial? This is the plaintiff, this is defendant. For a given issue, we state the element. intent to kill. The prosecution here says, yes, can't even spell Bilbo, intended to throw knife at Gollum. Bilbo's lawyer would say no, intended to throw at Shelob. But there's a little trial about this. The prosecution marshaled its best facts and sets them out here. Bilbo was under the sway of the ring and was jealous and thought that Gollum wanted to take the ring from him. And the defendant here says, no, you're scared of giant spiders. Of course, you would throw a knife at something like that. Here, in dealing with data gathering, you have to distinguish between easy issues, ones where there's no real debate, and hard ones that require you to go to court and to fight it out. The function of the conclusion portion of IRAC is to answer the hypothesis. And this is worded in a specific way. Usually the way I like to do is the better view is, and the answering the hypothesis takes place at the claim level, not at the element level. In the analysis section, you will actually come to conclusions on individual elements 1, 2, and 3. I think the thing that is missing from most teachings about IRAC is that each of these things involves a different narrative perspective. From in the literary sense, and I'm not trying to get into deep literary theory, but stuff that you learned in high school. In setting a legal hypothesis, we are entering, I'll use the Illuminati symbol here. It's an eye and a triangle as opposed to a piece of candy corn. This is the third person omniscient. And it's sort of all-seeing and all-knowing and objective. This stuff happened. Some event happened, and the question is, did X event constitute Y claim or crime having these elements? There's no real debate here. It's just setting the stage. And so when you're in this phase, the literary perspective is third-person omniscient. You see all, you know all, but you don't take sides yet. In the analysis section, the narrative perspective depends on whether or not you've determined that a particular element is easily answered or is basically a hard or close question. If it's easy, I think you can just fall into the third-person omniscient again. Because, hey, I mean, that's a knife in Gollum's face. That's an easy element to answer. If it's hard, the narrative perspective here is dialogue. And I think dialogue is basically first person, but it's the author speaking as individual people. So here, you're not speaking really as yourself. So let's just call this dialogue. You are basically the puppet master for these two sides, but you fully engage in that debate. First, you are entirely the plaintiff, then you're entirely the defendant, then you're entirely the plaintiff, but you are creating their dialogue here. So this is dialogic, if it's a harder issue. We end with the conclusion, and the conclusion is first person disguised. Here is you, and here is your disguise, a giant square beard and a wig. You will never, in an exam answer, actually say, I think. Never say, I think. That's implied. The way you word it is, the better view is Z, but you are being the judge here, and this is a judge's wig, but a conclusion is really just your personal view, but it's the first person disguised. Talk to you next time.